Welcome to Hydrology, Return Period and Probability. This is Chapter 3, Lecture 1. I'm Dr. Marty Matlock. Let's get started. We're all familiar with the distribution of rainfall across the United States. We're all familiar with our standard evening news predictions of rainfall or weather tomorrow or the next day and the 7-day outlook. Where does all this come from and what does it really mean? From a hydrologist's perspective, we talk about these events in probabilistic terms based upon periods of record and data, not feelings, but based upon empirical understanding of phenomena. And so we work with terms like 2-year 24-hour rainfall events and isohyedral lines across the continental United States. If we look at Fayetteville, Arkansas, in Washington County, you can see that our 2-year, 24-hour rainfall event, on average, should be less than about 4.2 inches, 4.1 and a half inches. So every over a 100-year period, we should have roughly 50 events of 4.1 inches. That's the way you understand probabilities. Rainfall occurs across this landscape in discrete events. It's not a continuous phenomena. Those events are characterized by frequency. They happen, then they don't, then they happen again over a period of time. Intensity, the amount of rain that falls per unit time. And duration, how long does that rainfall last? So frequency, intensity, and duration are critical characteristics of precipitation events. We'll return to that in Chapter 4. Frequency is how often they occur over a period of time. So if something happens 5 times in 10 years, then it has a frequency of 5 over 10 years, of 0.5. Months, years, and decades, etc., are the periods of times we talk about. Intensity is how much it rains per unit of time, minute, hour, day for each event, or year for that matter. Duration is how long it rains for a given intensity period. So if it's raining 6 inches an hour for 10 minutes, you get a certain amount of rain. But if it rains 6 inches an hour for 6 hours, that's a different story altogether. These three characteristics allow us to define rainfall events, simulate them, and predict their impacts. For a given event, rainfall, flood, drought, peak flow event, etc., the probability that the event will occur in a given year is the return period. A T-year event, a 25-year event, 50-year event, 100-year event, often referred to as the recurrence interval, is an event of a magnitude that over a long period of time, much longer than the number of years you're referencing, the average time between events having a magnitude greater than that event, that reference event, is 2 years. So that 2-year storm event that we were just looking at means that over a 50-year period, the 25 events greater than 4.2 inches would occur in Fayetteville, Arkansas, equal to or greater than over a 50-year period. Now, they could all happen in 1 year and then never happen again, and it doesn't really change that. It changes the distribution. But that's the thing about probabilities, is there's no measure of distance between the events. We have experienced in Northwest Arkansas in the last decade, 1 500-year event and 3 100-year events. The expected number of occurrences of a T-year event in an in-year period is N over T. A 2-year 24-hour rainfall intensity for Fayetteville, Arkansas is 4.1 inches. The expected number of occurrences of rainfall greater than 4.1 inches in Fayetteville in 10 years is 10 over 2, or 5. So we've already driven home the point that this does not mean that a T-year event occurs every 2 years. These are probabilities based upon historical data at a location. Our ability to quantify the probability of an event is based upon them being a stationary time series. The events have to be a stationary time series, which means that they meet these three criteria. A period of historical record greater than the time period you're concerned about. That's what makes 500-year flood event predictions impossible. We can only extrapolate. The events are independent. That is, it's not the same storm system that generates five events in a day or in a week. Hurricanes are examples of that. Hurricanes can create massive bands of rainfall, but those are not independent events. The conditions under which the events occurred have not changed. And boy, that's a doozy. The probability of an event for a specific magnitude occurring any given year is 1 over T. Probability of that event is 1 over T, the return period. So risk is a complex concept because it has very specific meanings in hydrology and also different meanings in common usage. So we live in a complex world that's difficult to understand and with phenomena that are occurring around us that are unprecedented. The likelihood of something occurring is often called the probability of the event. And it's generally categorized as a low, medium, or high probability event. However, in common language, we often refer to probabilities subjectively. They're based upon beliefs rather than data. The probability of the next candidate for president winning the election versus the incumbent not winning the election are subjective criteria because we have no data to base our predictions upon. All we can do is speculate. These phenomena are subjective probabilities, the probability that X team will win a championship, that Y person will win an election. They occur in everyday language. That's not what we talk about in hydrology when we talk about risk and probabilities. We talk about objective probabilities. They're based upon data rather than beliefs. When hydrogeologists talk about probabilities, we're referring to objective probabilities, events that have been observed over time, and about which we can make mathematical inferences regarding the potential for reoccurring. It's happened 20 times in the last 50 years. What's the probability it's going to happen again? Well, it's happened 20 times in the last 50 years. In the next 50 years, it'll probably happen 20 more times. That's the way we do things. It may not seem very sophisticated, but it's real. It's based upon observations and data. Probabilities are expressed as a range from 0 to 1, or in percentages, that probability times 100. The probabilities of 10, 25, 50, 100, and 500-year events are 0.1, 0.04, 0.02, 0.01, and 0.002, respectively. A probability of 0 means the event can never happen. That's very rare. In fact, as a scientist, it's hard for me to conceptualize a zero probability event. Incredibly unlikely, yes, but zero probability is an impossibility. A probability of 100 means the event will certainly happen. Now, we do have certainties. It will rain again. What's the probability that it will rain in the next 5 years on this planet? It's 100%. Perhaps I could modify that if I knew that we had an extra planetary event that was going to end the planet's existence. So perhaps I could stipulate, assuming that the planet is still here and we still have an atmosphere, it's 100%. So both are rare. We're more able to give an event a probability of 100 than 0 because we can predict what happens, but we can't predict what won't happen. Since these are independent events, they are considered random and meeting the criteria of the Bernoulli process, the probability P of any event Q sub T being exceeded in any year P sub T for all time and independent of historic occurrences of Q sub T. Sorry, folks, that's the nature of what we're in for the next 4 weeks in this class. We're deep into the language of probability. So it's a new language. It's a language of mathematics specialized in risk, so learn it. So the probability P of any event Q sub T being exceeded in any year for P sub T for all time and independent of historic occurrences of Q. For any event Q sub T denoted as Q sub T asterisk, we do not know the actual magnitude of Q sub T asterisk, only that it exceeds Q sub T. So we know that there will be 25 rainfall events in 50 years in Fayetteville, Arkansas. At least there's a high probability there will be 25 rainfall events in Fayetteville, Arkansas that exceed 4.1 inches in the next 50 years. In a binomial system, an event either occurs or it does not. So we don't know Q sub T asterisk if a six-year event will occur. We just know it'll be greater than 4.2. Now we can, there are other ways to find out for larger events, but for a given event, Q sub T, we can't tell how many will exceed that. They will be equal to or exceed that event. It either happens or it doesn't. That binomial distribution is incredibly powerful. Knowing that gives us the opportunity to analyze characteristics. The probability of an event occurring equals 1 minus the probability that it does not occur. What's the probability that it will rain tomorrow? 1 minus the probability that it will not rain tomorrow. So the probability equals of rain equals 1 minus the probability of sunshine. And the probability of sunshine equals 1 minus the probability of rain. Q sub T is a Bernoulli random variable, as we've established. The probability of K occurrences, 10, 20, 50 occurrences, of a particular event, QT asterisk, 6.2 inches, in a single year is calculated using the binomial distribution equation, where we have some function of K, P, T, and N equals N factorial over N minus K factorial times probability of K of T at K times 1 minus the probability of T to the N minus K, where the function of K, P, T, and N is the probability of exactly K occurrences of the event Q asterisk T in N years. For example, the probability of 7 occurrences of a 2-year rainfall event, 4.1 inches in Fayetteville, Arkansas, PT equals 0.5, in 20 years is function 7.5, 20 equals 20 factorial over 20 minus 7 factorial times 7 factorial times 0.5 to the 7th times 1 minus 0.5 to the 20th minus 7. So a factorial, you may not have seen that in a while, since calculus, I suppose, is exclamation point equals n times n minus 1 times n minus 2, so times ultimately 1. So 7 factorial equals 7 times 6 times 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. That can get to be big numbers very quickly. In Excel, this is how you create a factorial, or you create this equation. So you define the variables, t equals 2, so p sub t equals 0.5, k equals 1, n equals 20, and then you create the equation, which is factorial e7 divided by factorial e7 minus e5 times factorial e5 times e6 to the e5th times 1 minus e6 to the e7th minus e5th. Make sure you get your parentheses in the right places so that you actually execute the equation in the manner in which the formula dictates. The probability of 7 occurrences of a 2-year rainfall event in 20 years is 0.074, or 7.4%. This equation calculates the probability of exactly K events of Q T asterisk in years. The probability of 7 occurrences of a 2-year rainfall event in 20 years is 0.074, or 7.4%. The probability of 1 2-year rainfall event in 20 years is 0.000191. Well, that seems odd, because it should be a very high probability that we'll have 1. No, this is the probability of only 1 event, a 2-year event happening in 20 years. So understand what this probability is telling us. It's the exact probability of the exact number of events of an exact magnitude in an exact period of time. When I say exact, I mean specified. This is critically important to remember. The binomial equation calculates the probability of the precise number of events in a time span. Generally, we're more interested in exceedance probabilities, or the probability that a certain year event, a 20-year event, a 100-year event, will be exceeded at least once in n-year time period. So that's something that we are more engaged with as hydrologists. The exceedance probability of an event occurring over a specific time period, at least one exceedance, is 1 minus the probability of no exceedances. So it's 1 minus that the equation we just developed, where k equals 0 and 0 factorial by definition is 1. I don't understand why. I could go back and do the proof, but it's 1. Therefore, the probability that a t-year event will be exceeded at least once in an n-year period equals, this is a function of p sub t n equals 1 minus 1 minus 1 over t to the n. Very simple now. Notice there are no factorials there. The probability that a 2-year rainfall event, p sub t equals 0.5, will occur at least once in 20 years, at least once, is 0.99999905. So the probability that it will occur at least once is almost certain. The probability that it'll occur only once is incredibly rare. When n approaches t, then fptn approaches a constant of 0.632. That means the probability of exceeding a 1-year storm event in 1 year is 0.632, or 63.2%. The probability of exceeding a 100-year storm event in 100 years is 63%. That just has to do with the distribution, the centroid of our probability theorem. This is a critical concept for engineers. If you're designing a bridge to withstand a 100-year event with a 100-year life, what number would you use? If your bridge will only withstand a 100-year event and it's got to live for 100 years, you'd better not use the 100-year event as your design criteria, because you got a 63% chance it will be exceeded. Those aren't good odds for an engineer. So how do you calculate the required design period to achieve a specific confidence that an exceedance event will not occur during the design life? This is where the logic of binomial distributions becomes really handy. Remember that the probability of a t-year event will be exceeded at least once in n-year period. So fptn equals 1 minus 1 minus 1 over tn. Therefore, the probability the t-year event will not be exceeded in n-years equals 1 minus this, 1 minus that function of ptn. If we want to be 90% certain of not exceeding a design storm event of t years in 25-year life, we solve for t. So solving for t means that 0.1 equals 0.1, which is 1 minus 90, equals 1 minus 1 minus 1 over t to the 25th. Solving for t, we get 238-year return period. If you want to be 90% certain of not exceeding a design storm event of t years in a 25-year life, then if you can be in 20 a 25-year life, you have to design for a 230-year, 8-year design event to be 90% confident it will not be the event will not be exceeded. The degree of risk that is acceptable for exceedance events and design life of the structures are decisions we make as engineers in any hydrologic project. Acceptability of risk is a function of regulations, policies, client requirements, and engineering ethics. High confidence that is low uncertainty generally means high cost. We rely on a lot of data. that's been developed by those who have come before us, and maintained by state and federal agencies and some international agencies for this work. TR-55 and rainfall maps of the U.S. are in your readings. They're available to you. This is essentially a handbook for you for urban hydrology for small watersheds. Now, we're only going to focus on the appendices, which are the rainfall distribution maps in this lecture, but we'll be touching back to TR-55 many times during this semester. Get used to taking these reading documents as reference documents and going through the table of contents. You can't really read every document I give you in the time period we have for this class. We just don't have enough time. But you can familiarize yourself with what content is in them, and then you can go to the content you're most interested in. Often that when you get there to chapter 3, for example, you'll see content that requires you to refer back to chapter 2. So just be patient. That's the nature of this sort of reference learning. There are four major storm types in the United States. When we look at when a storm happens in over a 24-hour period, it starts raining at midnight, stops raining at 11:59 p.m. We typically have different categories of storms in terms of the rainfall. If 100% of the rainfall, that 4.1 inches of a 25 or a two-year return period in Fayetteville, that 4.1 inches will fall based upon where you are in the United States on these types of designs, these four different designs. Now we have types 1A, 2, and 3 storms. Now type 1 storms are the midpoint. You know, basically you get half the rain, 2.05 inches, in about early, in about 9.9 hours and 45 minutes. In a type 2 event, you get half the rain in 12 hours. The type 2 event distributes the rainfall very much like a normal distribution. If you were to look at the rainfall over the 12-hour or 24-hour period, you'd see just a hump, and then it comes back down equally on this side. Type 1 is skewed a little bit to the left, to the lower end. It happens earlier. And type 1A happens even earlier. You get half the rainfall occurs in under 9 hours, and then it tapers off after that. These rainfall distributions are important because you have to understand how when a rainfall event occurs, how that rain is going to occur. Many times we only have data on a 24-hour rainfall event, but we don't know when the rain occurred during that 24 hours, and we can't just assume that someone turned on the valve at midnight and it rained exactly the same intensity all through the night and the next day and the next night. What we have, that sort of uniform rainfall distribution, which would look like on this diagram, just a straight line from 0 to 100, is not what we see. It's just not the way rainfall happens. It starts a little slow, then it picks up and it's really intense, then it tapers off again. That's the typical way our rainfall events occur. Depending on where you are in the United States, you experience these storms by and large under these type of categories. The 1A storms are really in the Pacific Northwest and the Sierra Nevada mountains of California and Northern California. So we would call it in sort of the wet rainfall area. Type 1 storms are in the Mediterranean areas of Southern California, Alaska, and Hawaii. Type 1A storms, of course, are those upper West Coast storms. Type 2 storms are for the rest of us. And then type 3 storms really only occur in the Gulf of Mexico impacted states, Southern Florida, and the Atlantic coastal region. Washington County, Arkansas is right on the edge of 2 and 3. So we really get both. So if we look at these 2 and 3, there's not a lot of difference in them anyway. Type 3 storms, they both have a midpoint. Half the rain hits at 12 hours. It's the rate of tapering off, and it's the rate of going faster. The type 3 storms tend to if we look at them here, the type 3 storms tend to start a little slower and then get going faster and then taper off a little faster. These seem subtleties, like subtle differences, but we will have to generate artificial 24-hour rainfall events in this class. And as hydrologists, you have to do that too. Knowing which type of storm to use and to look up in order to create those is important. So for us, this is type 3. If you throw a type 2 storm, if you're working up in northern Benton County or in Oklahoma, in western Oklahoma, you're going to use type 2. That's fine. They're very close. There was a time when we had to do all the work of developing precipitation duration and recurrence intervals manually with rainfall data from a location. And I had to walk uphill both ways to school in the snow too. You don't have to do that anymore. If we go to the NOAA rainfall data site, you can actually put a cursor on a map, zoom in, and get really close to a location, and it will automatically calculate for that location precipitation depths for durations at recurrence intervals up to 1,000 years. Crazy, huh? So a 24-hour rainfall event at this location in Little Rock, you can see a 1,000-year rainfall event in 24 hours, exceedance event, it's about 14 inches. A one-year event is about 4 inches. Remember, Fayetteville, our two-year event was about 4.1. Little Rock's a little wetter than we are. Again, we can look at the average recurrence down here, which is just taking these data, putting them on the x-axis, and giving us precipitation depth on the y-axis like above, and then giving us the different durations, 5 minutes to 24 hours, etc. And what's really cool is then we can also look at tabular graphical data on precipitation and recurrence intervals. So we selected a 24-hour recurrence interval. And so we have upper and lower bounds, 90% upper and lower bounds, which we're going to talk a lot about this over the duration of this class, with the precipitation frequency estimates. Notice that this is a log axis on the x-axis. Everything's sort of clustered down here at the beginning. So we end up with this parabolic curve that asymptotes over time at sort of the maximum events for an area. NOAA collects data using land-based data stations all around the United States. The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration maintains these, as well as do states, universities, USGS, EPA, other agencies. And the type of information they provide is pretty robust, and you have immediate access to it all over the nation. So some of these go from June 2019 back to May 2000 for some here we have an 1895 to 2020 range period, so you can, it's amazing the sort of data you have access to. Climate data online can be downloaded, so you go to the USGS or the NOAA station and you select your location, put in your zip code or a city, and it will give you a number of weather stations that they have data for. And I picked Fayetteville, Arkansas, this one, not Fayetteville, North Carolina, pay attention. But you can also see all the other weather stations in the region, and you can zoom in and get a closer range of that. You can tell NOAA with these drop-down menus what kind of data you want. I wanted 15-minute precipitation ranging from 1970 to 2014. I use cities, Fayetteville, Arkansas to find it. And then I added it to my cart and I downloaded it as comma delimited files, CSVs, that I could drop immediately into Excel. And then it emailed it to me. So this is what I get. I get two types of data, QGAG and QPCP. QGAG is the volume of precipitation calculated by weight accumulated in measuring buckets as recorded at the station for 15-minute periods ending at the time specified for date. QPCP is the amount of precipitation recorded at the station for 15-minute period ending at the time for specified date, given in hundreds of inches or tenths of millimeters, depending on what you want. By the way, you can use Control-H to find replace error numbers. So if you're looking through the data, you're going to see that a lot of times you're going to see these automated numbers like -9999 or +9999. Those are nonsensical numbers. What that means is they can't do zeros. Zero is two, you can't divide things by zero, so they have default numbers. When there are no changes or very small changes in the mass, you see they actually had evaporation in the system. You get these null values, and what you have to do is just replace them with zeros. The other thing we can do is we can look up frequency data, as we showed you earlier, and you can zoom right into a project watershed and put the crosshairs right on your project watershed, and you can get the 5-minute to 60-day rainfall predictions for up to 1,000-year return periods with 90% confidence intervals. So for this site, a 100-year flood event for a 24-hour period is 7.93 inches, right under 8 inches, or we can be 90% confident it's between 6.7 and 9.34 inches. That is super cool and easy. The data are in CSV format files. You drop those into Excel, and then you can adjust them very effectively. You can use them for your models, for calculations. Lots of information here to review. You'll have a quiz and homework associated with each of these lectures, of course. I encourage you to go to each of these sites, make notes on each of them so that you can return to them as you need to, and become familiar with what these sites represent. Thank you.